Hello, I'm Kyle Marsh from the Identity and Network Access Group here at Microsoft. And in this video, I'm going to go through the steps to protect your API using Azure AD. The first thing you need to do to protect your app, or your API rather, using Azure AD, is you need to register the API. As far as we're concerned, this is just another app registration with a particular set of attributes set in that registration. The first thing you need to realize is you don't need something like a redirect URI, because you're not going to be receiving your tokens directly from Azure AD, but rather from the client application calling your API. So there is no interactive user authentication needed for your API. But what we do need to do is we need to define what is known as the application ID URI. This is really just the unique identifier your client developers will use when they ask permission to call your API as a resource. Now, by default, we'll suggest using API colon slash slash and then the client ID from your API's registration, because we know that to be unique across all of Azure Active Directory and Microsoft Identity. However, that's not the most user-friendly string to remember. So you may prefer to use something like an HTTP address that aligns with the actual address of your API, so it's easier for your client developers to know which API they're asking us an access token for. Now, I do have to follow some rules there. The domain has to be part of my publishing from my tenant. I wouldn't, for example, want to use something like my onmicrosoft.com necessarily. And I do have to still be unique, have a unique address, because this is how we're identifying your API as the access token needed. The next thing you need to do is you need to define and design your delegated permissions. Now, you need to keep in mind that you need to help your developers, those client developers, have a least privilege approach. So that means you as an API designer need to create least privilege options and avoid using, for example, simply access as user and having a single consent. Maybe if your API is of a very limited nature and not very extensive, then maybe that might be a good scope. But I prefer the idea of allowing your developers to follow a least privilege model, which you need to keep in mind as you design these delegated permissions. And then finally, you do the same thing and help. You do need to state which of your permissions that you create should be allowed to have user consent, because, for example, it only affects that individual users and not other users, and it doesn't have a particularly broad capability, like something like updating all of the records in the system. Those are things that might be user consentable, whereas if it affects multiple users, if it has a broad impact, those are the kinds of things you'd want to make sure require admin consent. So be conservative. Error toward the side of admin consent when in doubt. And then you define your application permissions. Now, the way you do that is you actually, these are implemented as application roles or app roles that can be assigned or have what we refer to as an allowed member type of an application. You still want to follow the idea of giving your application permissions a least privilege model, but we'll go through defining all of those. So let's take a look at how we would do that. So here, I've already created my core app registration. I have my API for video here, and I have my all-important application or client ID, which is going to be my audience claim. When I get a token, I'll be checking to make sure that the token is this audience, this ID. Now, I will do some housekeeping here. I just created this app registration, and by default, we always add the permission of sign in and read the user profile, because it's what most applications need to do. We're going to remove that because we're an API, so we're not signing in the user. We're not reading the user's profile here. So instead, we're going to go to our Expose an API blade, and we're going to start by defining our application ID URI. Again, the suggested unique value is API colon slash slash. Nothing wrong with using that. I can also, of course, create an HTTP address. Notice here, as you type in, we'll let you know which URI patterns are allowed. I'll go with HTTP here, and I'll go ahead and do my API at my tenant, Microsoft Identity .dev. So now I have a unique identifier so that applications can ask to get an access token to this unique API, if you will. Now I'll go ahead and define my delegated permissions by adding a scope. And here I will go ahead and start following a least privilege model. So I'll start by having a permission that will start with a read permission. And in this, I will say, yes, reading is okay for users to grant. So I've made a decision here that, in my opinion, a user can consent to this. Remember, a tenant admin can always overrule this, so the application developer can't rely on it being user consentable because a tenant admin may have overruled my API designer suggestion. So here I do have an opportunity to provide different UIs, whether an admin is consenting or a user is consenting. So here I might say, read the user's data. Oops. And now I would give a description to the admin about what the impact of granting this consent would be. So in this case, the app can read all data the user can access. Now I'll also take the opportunity, since it is going to be user consentable, to have a special string just for the user. So in this case, it'll be read your data. And the description here is that the app can access your data. And now I've set up a first delegated permission that is user consentable. And now add an additional scope. I have the two scopes so that I have a least privileged model. Applications that don't do any updating shouldn't not ask for the update permission. In this case, the display name will be update data, and we'll tell the description here that the app can update . So I give that description and I'll go ahead and add that scope. So now I've set up my delegated permissions, and I could go to a client that has a user signing in, like my client for video here, and I'll go to my API permissions blade, and I can now add an additional permission. Obviously, it's not one of these Microsoft ones. We make it easily accessible on the first page. I could search and find that API here in my organization. Or I'll take a shortcut since I have the API. I can go directly to the APIs I own this way. And here you see we've enabled the delegated permissions tab. We have not yet enabled the application permissions tab. And here's that information we typed in to help the admin in this case, or the developer, select their privilege they need. This is the read. And now this application can use this whole string, remember, with its full identification of HTTPS. /api.microsoftidentity.dev/read. That's the scope name, and now that the application would be able to get a token for that. Now let's go ahead and look at our application permissions. We do this by app roles instead of a scope. So I'll go ahead here and create an app role. Again, I can follow least privilege here. This will be read all data, or read, the display name will be read all data. It'll be assigned to applications. The value here will be read all. And the description is the app can read all data for all users, because I can't constrain this any more than simply it can access all of the data in that resource. Again, I can create a least privileged model here. So this is update all data. Again, assigned to an application, with the value of update all. Now, if I wanted to have the same names here, it's possible, but I can't use the editor. I have to use the application manifest in order to have where the name of my permission is the same, whether it's a user consent, an application permission, or a user, a delegated permission. So here the app can update all data for all users. Okay, so now I've defined both delegated permissions and application permissions. Obviously, I wouldn't go back to that same client application that's acting as a user signing in and have that ask for an application permission. That's an area of concern whenever I see that. Instead, I'll take a look here. I have a service defined, a separate application. I'm going to do one cleanup here. As I go to ask for my application permission, I'm going to remove this delegated permission because that would create the opportunity for my application to accidentally allow a user to do something they couldn't normally do. So I always want to avoid that. Instead, I'll now go add my application permission, jump to my APIs. There's our API. Now notice both application and delegated permission tabs are enabled. I'll go ahead to my application permissions, and there again is that information we did as part of our app role. So I'll go ahead here, ask for the permission, and now a tenant admin must come. And notice it's marked here as it's not been granted, so this application can't run until it has been granted. So a tenant admin will have to come and push this button and actually enable this application permission for my service. So an application permission, the key element here is that we can deliver the token to your application via the access token that's given to you by a client application. You can't trust the client application, so you must validate the token. First off, by checking its signature, making sure all the claims are valid. We strongly encourage you to use a well-maintained JSON web token library here. There are some known vulnerabilities in token validation for JSON tokens, JSON web tokens. So it's best that you use, again, a well-maintained library, like, for example, what you get with Microsoft Identity.web for our ASP.NET Core builders. But there are other well-maintained libraries depending upon what you're building your services in. Make sure you check the signature. Make sure you also validate the claims. For example, that audience claim has to be your app ID, etc. And then key to this is you actually have to do the enforcement, not only of things like token lifespan, but also when you have a delegated permission token, make sure that the application permission is the intersection of what the user can do as well. So what you're actually going to provide here as an effective permission, you're going to say, what has this application been granted by looking at the scope claim? You're going to look at the user's identity that's available in that access token, determine what the user is allowed to do with the reference to this access to the resource, and then you're going to do that enforcement. So the way you protect an API with Azure AD, first off, you register the API. You define your application ID URI, so you have a unique identifier, so someone can ask for a token specifically for your API. Define your delegated permissions. Keep in mind allowing developers to be least privileged when they call your API. Be cautious about which you allow, which of these consents you suggest are user consentable as opposed to which ones require admin consent. And then you define your application permissions using the app roles for applications. And finally, when you get those access tokens from your client calls, make sure you validate them, check the signature, make sure the claims align, check expiration, and so on, before you move ahead and then operate as expected based on the call that's made from the application and its accompanying access token. So good luck with your protection of your APIs using Azure Active Directory, and thank you very much.